Thanks for the introduction. So this is the outline of the talk. Essentially, I will start with a few words of introduction and motivation and try to explain what are the challenges that we face when we want to implement masking in parallel. I will follow with the description of this new leakage model called the bounded moment model and try to explain why it's actually relevant to analyze the security of parallel implementations. And I will also argue that security in this new model is actually implied by security in the well-known probing model. I will then try to show how we can exploit parallelism in order to design very efficient multiplication gadgets. And I will conclude the talk by discussing a little bit the fact that security in the bounded moment model is actually weaker than probing security and what are the implications of this observation. So, to start the introduction, I would like to say a few words about side-channel attacks, which, very summarized, can be viewed as physical attacks that decrease the security of an implementation exponentially in the number of measurements. And if I take a very simple, maybe naive example, we could imagine a block cipher with a 128-bit key. And each time the adversary makes a measurement, he gets one key bit, so that after 128 measurements, the adversary gets the key in full. And of course, that's a little bit oversimplifying, because in practice, what happens is that each time we want to recover a key bit, we have to distinguish between two noisy distributions here represented by the two red and orange Gaussians. And of course, that suggests that if we want to improve security against side-channel attacks, one natural way to do that is to try improving the noise or increasing the noise. And for example, this can be done by leveraging what we call algorithmic noise or additive noise. And the idea is that by doubling the size of the circuit, you have more things happening in the implementation that you don't target in the attack, and that's going to increase the noise. But somehow, this is still not good in terms of security, because essentially, if you want to double the security, you will have to double the cost of your implementation, which is not nice as a security parameter. And that's exactly where masking comes into play. So intuitively, I would say masking can really be viewed as noise amplification. And I will try to explain this with the most famous example, which is Boolean encoding. So what we have here is a secret value y that you want to share, or that we share in d different pieces. D minus one pieces are obtained randomly. The last one is computed accordingly. And if we want to reason about security of this type of encodings, one convenient way is to use the abstract model called probing security, and that was introduced by Shai Sahai and Wagner in 2003. And the idea there is that the adversary can probe a certain number of wires. If he probes up to d minus one wires, he will not gain any information about the secret, but if he gets one more wire, then of course he can recover the secret in full. And this is, of course, a quite abstract view of security, but the expectation is that when we implement this encoding in a real device, what happens is that the device is going to manipulate the D different shares at different points in time, and the adversary will receive what we call a leakage trace. So this is really the power consumption or the electromagnetic radiation of the implementation. What's important is that we hope that every share will be manipulated in different cycles. And the expectation is that if we give that to the adversary, we still have some kind of security reflected by the fact that the information leakage is going to be bounded. And in particular, what's important is that the information is raised to a certain power, which corresponds to the number of shares. And this has been later formalized as noise leakage security by Proof and Rivin in 2013. And what's very interesting, or one very nice result in this field, is due to Duc, Jamborski, and Faust in 2014, because they showed that this very convenient abstract model called probing security actually implies concrete security in the noisy leakage model under two assumptions that we can somehow verify empirically. One is the fact that the leakage corresponding to the shares are sufficiently noisy, and the other condition is that these leakages are independent. And that's extremely convenient because it shows, and that's exactly what Gilles said in the morning, that we can actually do all the security analysis in this abstract model and then gain something concretely useful. Now, what are the questions we started with in this talk or in this work? The first one, which is probably the main one, is what happens with parallel implementations. And well, first, I have to explain what is a parallel implementation. Essentially, it's an implementation that will manipulate all the shares in one clock cycle. So rather than having all these cycles where the shares are manipulated, I put them all in parallel, and I will, of course, require a bit more power consumption to do that. And then, well, one question that we could ask is what happens if we do this probing attack, and the probing adversary obtains the sum of all the shares. And clearly, we see that directly we don't have probing security in the sense that this sum is leaking something about the secret, which we don't have usually in the probing model. And essentially, the question here is whether the probing model, which was very convenient for serial implementation, is also applicable or relevant to parallel implementations. The other question, or the second question we ask ourselves, which is a bit more consolidating, is whether it's serial or parallel, all these masked implementations heavily rely on the fact that the leakage of the shares is independent, so how can we test that? In the case of a serial implementation, it means that we need independence over time, which corresponds to the x-axis of the figure. In the case of a parallel implementation, it's going to be independence over the y-axis, which corresponds to the leakage. And of course, ideally, we would like to do that without directly working in the noisy leakage model, essentially because it's a bit more difficult to manipulate. So it would be convenient to have something simpler than directly dealing with the full distributions. So I will now introduce the model that we use to reason about that. And I will start with a few words about the statistical intuition that we have in masking. And I will illustrate this with a two-share and one-bit example for a serial implementation. So what we have here is we have two leakage samples. The first one is a noisy version of the first share. The second leakage sample is a noisy version of the second share. And what we give to the adversary is essentially these two distributions, right? If the secret is zero, he can observe 0, 0 or 1, 1 plus noise. If the secret is one, he can observe 1, 0 or 0, 1 plus noise. And clearly, we see that we have information, we can distinguish the two distributions. What's interesting here is that if we compute or if we estimate the mean vector of these two distributions, it's going to be 0.5, 0.5, and 0.5, 0.5, independent of the value that we manipulate. So at least something happens compared to the unprotected case where we only needed to estimate the mean. Here, we need to estimate the covariance of the distribution. And what's convenient with respect to parallelism is that, of course, this reasoning extends to my example where the adversary can observe a sum of the share. So here, for example, the adversary has one leakage sample that is a sum of the two shares plus noise, and the two univariate distributions are like that. So again, either the adversary observes 0, 2 or always 1. And what's going to allow the adversary to distinguish the distribution is not the mean, because the value is 1 anyway, it's the variance, which is different in the two cases. And this gives motivation for formalizing something that's pretty well known, I think, in the chess community, which is that we could say an implementation is secure at order O in this bounded moment leakage model if all the statistical moments of the leakage distributions are independent of any sensitive variable manipulated by the target device, up to order O, of course. Sorry. Now, we have this tool to reason about parallel implementations. The first question that we ask ourselves is whether probing model was still relevant in this case. And we answer this question in the paper with a kind of abstract reduction, which says informally that if you have a parallel implementation, it's going to be secure at order O in this bounded moment model if its serialized version is secure at order O in the probing model. And essentially, we will consider the probing adversary who can probe up to D minus one wires, and the bounded moment adversary who can observe any sum of the shares. So I guess intuitively it's kind of expected that this holds because summing the shares in the reals is not supposed to break the independence condition. What I think is interesting is that we have significant differences between the two models. One is somehow useful is the fact that this bounded moment adversary can sum over all the shares. So it means really we don't need to exclude one share like in the probing model. We can really give everything to the adversary, but he can only observe the sum. And this is going to be very useful later on to argue about continuous security. And of course, we need to pay something for that. And what we pay is the fact that the bounded moment security notion is strictly weaker, right? Because we now reason about statistical moments and not about the full distributions. So what does it mean concretely? Essentially, it means that if you have an abstract implementation that you prove secure in the probing model and also secure in the bounded moment model, because it's implied, and on the top of this, you have a concrete implementation such that you have physically independent leakages, so the implementation is not mixing the shares in a strange manner, then bounded moment security directly extends to actual measurements. And I just show here an example with three shares. On the upper left figure, you have a concrete trace. All the other ones are what we call detection. So we try to extract or to detect information depending on the means, the variance, and the skewness. And what we see here is that only the skewness leads to clearly detectable patterns. So only the skewness is providing information to the adversary. And that actually answers the second question that we ask ourselves, which is, how to test independence. In fact, testing the statistical moments is a good solution for that, or a very convenient one, because if you don't have that, you can clearly claim that leakages are not independent, which is, again, something that has been used intensively in the chess literature for many years. Now, we know that we can manipulate shares in parallel, so parallel masking is allowed. We know what we can hope for that, like bounded moment security and probably noisy leakage security. What I'd like to do now is to argue a little bit about what we can gain in terms of performance. And I will illustrate that with a multiplication algorithm, and starting with a serial multiplication inspired from the paper of Fischer, Sahai, and Wagner in 2003. And here what we do is multiplication between two shared secrets, A and B. And we went to learn the three shares of C. And well, intuitively, the algorithm essentially works by computing partial products, refreshing these partial products by adding new randomness, and then compressing. Now, if I apply this to the ASS box, so the S box is, of course, 8-bit wide, and for simplicity, I will consider a case with 8 shares. The implementation will work such as we put in every 8-bit register 1 GF2 to the 8 elements, and then memory is going to be proportional to n times d, and time proportional to d square multiplications in GF2 to the 8. And of course, that's this quadratic time overhead is what really is expensive in practice. And applied to the ASS box, it means, of course, that we will need 3 multiplications to implement the S box. So what we propose in the paper is essentially to tweak this algorithm by better interleaving and regularizing the operations. So for example, what we do for three shares is we are going to separate the computation of the partial products and the refresh. And the refresh is going to be very simple. It's only adding fresh randomness or XORing with it and rotating the randomness. So that overall, the only thing that we need to implement that is XOR operations and rotations, which are all very efficient in concrete devices. If we do that for the ASS box, same story, it's an 8-bit S box. I will take 8 shares. The main or the only difference, in fact, is previously we were storing 1 share in an 8-bit register. Now, in 1 8-bit register, I store 8 shares, and the shares are all in GF2. Okay, so essentially, we move to a bit slice representation of the S box. Memory is unchanged, of course. We still require n times d. But what's interesting is that time is now going to be linear in D, because essentially what we need to perform is these AND operations on the columns, and this can be done in parallel for all the shares and in one clock cycle. Now, if you want to apply that, of course, the ASS bit slices box requires more multiplications, more AND gates, like 32 for the moment, I think. So essentially, the message is that we expect that we will have nice performance gains if we increase the number of shares, like 8, 16, or 32 if we take current devices. And I would argue that this is typically the number of shares that you need if you want to claim high security levels. Like if you want to claim that you have security up to the 50 or to the 60 measurements, this is something completely realistic. Of course, we analyzed the security of this new multiplication algorithm. In particular, we looked at a slightly stronger security notion than probing security, which is strong non-interference, also discussed by Jill in the morning. And this is an interesting notion because it's again composable. So if you show that for one small gadget, it means that we can put all sorts of gadgets together, build an implementation, and we are going to preserve security. So we show in the paper that by iterating d-1 divided by 3 refresh algorithm, we have something SNI up to d smaller than 12. And for multiplication, it's a bit more tricky. So as such, multiplication is only SNI for d equal 3. But if we compose the refresh and multiplication algorithm, it remains SNI up to d equals to 8. And we also gain there a little bit of randomness compared to the algorithm of Ishai Sahai and Wagner. And of course, all this is based on an automated tool, so it would be very interesting to make a mathematical proof that holds for any possible order and maybe to improve that. So far we showed that we can mask in parallel, we showed that we can gain performance and we have nice possibility to implement that in software devices by manipulating things with simple AND, XOR, rotate operations. I would like to finish by discussing a little bit the fact that the bounded moment security or bounded moment security does not imply probing security. And what does it mean? So we'll start with specialized encodings. And well, as I said, probing security is stronger than bounded moment security. It's also stronger than noisy leakage security. The question I'd like to ask is whether it is sometimes too strong. And of course, you could say a model is never too strong, which is somehow true. What I exactly mean is the question is somehow, does it sometimes happen that we break something in this probing model, despite the gadget is expected to have some kind of practical security against DPA, for example? And of course, if we take the Boolean encoding, the answer is no, because we've seen previously with two shares, the mean is going to be independent of the secret, not the variance, and this corresponds to the number of probes that you need, and if you increase the number of shares, this will scale. But interestingly, we have other types of encodings in the literature, for example, inner product encodings. In this case, what you do is you do masking in larger fields, like GF2 to the 8, and if I will assume for now that we have a special type of leakage function that doesn't mix the bits within this GF2 to the 8 field, then we can show that for this inner product encoding, which is essentially encoding as the near product between a public vector P and a secret vector S, it is possible to have security or the security order in the bounded moment model that is larger than 2, so larger than the number of shares. Here, it's an example in GF2 to the 8 where we can go up to 3. So that's nice because it shows that at least there are some properties that seem relevant to practice, like this bounded moment security, that are not at all captured by the probing model. So here, at least the fact that it's weaker gives us something. I would say even more interestingly, it has nice impact in the context of continuous attacks. So what do I mean here? So far, essentially, I discussed what I would call one-shot attacks. But this contradicts a little bit what I said in the introduction, because I said in the first slide, side channel attacks are essentially continuous attacks, where the adversary measures more and more and essentially accumulates information about the secret. And a typical issue that happens in this case is if you take this very simple refresh where we add a share of 0, which is the refresh algorithm that I gave previously, and this is, I think, frequently used in practice because it's very cheap and nice to implement, this refreshing gadget is actually insecure in the continuous probing model. And the question that I would like to ask finally is, what does it mean in practice? So can we sometimes use such a simple refreshing gadget? And to give intuitions about that, I'd like to maybe first describe what is this continuous probing attack. So the target is really this refresh algorithm where we have a secret A. We XOR with the randomness and we XOR with the rotation of the randomness. Initially, I have 4 shares, but it holds for any number of shares and no information. At the first step, I will probe one wire, okay, this one, the first share. I accumulate this and then I do the refreshing. So I XOR with the random vector, the rotation of the random vector, and I have A2. And what the attack will always do is probe only 3 wires, so 3 wires independent of D. I do that here, I take these 3 wires. What's easy to see, if I XOR the first line, I'm actually able to deduce the first bit of the encoding in the second step, and since I probed the second one, I can accumulate, and at the second step, I have 2 bits of my secret, of my shares. If it goes on, third step, again, I will probe 3 wires, and I will do the same type of things. I'm going to XOR the two first lines of the implementation. We observe that these 2 bits cancel each other, and essentially, I can learn the XOR between the 2 first bits after 3 steps. Since I probed the third one, then essentially, I can learn 3 bits. And if I go on like that, essentially, after D iterations, the adversary will be able to learn the secret in full. So that's annoying because that seems realistic. And what's very interesting, I think, is that these type of attacks are not possible in the bounded moment model. And that relates to something that I said earlier intuitively. So the key point is that this attack that I showed here in the continuous probing model crucially relies on the fact that the adversary can adaptively choose his probes. But in fact, if you're in the bounded moment model, it's not helping so much because the adversary can anyway have all the probes or the sum of all the probes, so adaptation doesn't have much impact here. And of course, we discuss in the paper the details. It doesn't mean that you can always use this type of refreshing algorithm, but one nice application is that this linear refresh can be used to refresh the key of key homomorphic encryption scheme. And that means that if you have that, you would have fully linear overheads. So that's at least interesting. And it leads me to the conclusion. I think one first conclusion is that, and that's maybe the most important one, probing security is actually relevant to parallel implementation. So all these nice things, starting with abstract probing security, still holds in this case. And I would say this bounded moment model formalizes or suggests a principled path to security evaluation where you would start from something abstract, then use bounded moment security to test independence, and finally quantify the noise to get noisy leakage security. In this paper, we really focused on the connections between probing and bounded moment security, and of course, there remains noise work to be done in the connections between bounded moment and noisy leakage security, in particular, what are the conditions that make these two things equivalent. One of the facts that we showed is that parallel implementations are extremely appealing for masking in software implementations, and this is because they really leverage the memory that you anyway need to store the shares. So it's usually something useful. And finally, I would say the last example, or this is a nice topic for further research, but this continuous probing thing probably suggests that continuous probing security is sometimes too strong to capture the security that we have in the case of DPA. So that makes also a slight difference between probing and concrete sectional attacks. Thank you.